what's the important product design in Charcha? What all needs to be for design?
That's a big question, but let me try to answer with a certain amount. Key thing is about, I talked about, when you think about a product, I'm a strong believer of the size of the market you're going to address, right? So even if a fraction of it, it matters a lot. The effort to do something for a small market and a big market, the difference is not linear. It is only delta is very small. But if you can address that market, so your thinking process has to be, can I serve the world globe, right? So start from there, and if you can, and especially in today's world, because it's, anybody can reach anybody in this plant at any point of time. It's completely flat, right? Through the, if you're looking at especially, internet-based, most of the opportunities are in those directions. So there is nothing stopping you from thinking those lines. So for example, now I see a lot of startups talking about India-centric dimension. But then, this is the thinking process, but you always need to prove, you need to do the proof of concept, right? You need to make your product work. There's a lot of philosophy, lean startups, and people think about, it is important that you start very lean and then make the product work in one market, then adopt to the subsequent market. That is true. I did the same thing. I made it work in Indian context. Then I took to the international, made it work in one place. Then we expanded to the rest of the market. And after that, we went into multiple industries, right? So that has to be done. That's what I was talking about, the orbital growth. But if your direction should be slightly, definitely global. Then in terms of features, what customers love. The product, that's what it should be focused on. Yeah.
You started your company in 1999. Your product in
1997. No. No, I think the first 5 years was I built for DOT. So that product I didn't own. So the first product I created for ourselves was in 1995. Even the DOT or the other one? See, because the first product was I was doing after I built the product for the DOT, right? So that was definitely tough because in the sense, it had to be completed in 6 months and the specification was one-liner saying that computer is telephone revenue accounting system. Need to be delivered in 6 months. So you had to find out entire requirement of the software, develop it, and the system was running in a manual form. You had to establish the process and redesign the process for an automated environment and train the people and then produce the invoice. So all in 6 months. So it was tough. So it was almost continuous 18 hours of programming and work, more than 2 days non-stop and things like that. So the highest I did was almost 3 days of continuous programming, without any sleep. So you could, the third day it was pretty much, you'll start seeing the stars. So that, but that was fun, to be very frank. Every day of that I still remember. Yeah. So as an entrepreneur, you need to do right from janitor's job to everything, right? So I said, if nobody else is doing that job, you should better go and do. So from which part I like the most personally, definitely I like the technology part. That is what programming. I know that's my nature. But which is most important thing which I enjoy is the strategy, creating the strategy for the organization and trying to, that is what I, excites me more right now. The other one is second nature to me. I can programming, I don't have to think, it comes to my mind automatically. So, I was a C programmer, the contract mandated me to write in COBOL. So I had to write in COBOL, but then, I didn't enjoy the first part, but then subsequently they agreed to translate that into C. So it was moved to C on a later part of the project. And after that, it was all in Oracle, and in those days, Oracle, very early stages, Oracle 5 was what we started with. And it was, if you know the VT 100 terminals and all that.
Yeah, so yeah, the database.
Yeah, it just started. It was, you know, in fact, Oracle expertise itself was very, very rare. So, in fact, when we did this, one of our challenges was, I mean, you also need to remember a few things. I mean, during this 95 and 2000, this was the era of Y2K and .com. I had a lot of opportunity in those areas. I would have become a completely different organization if I had gone to a services organization model. But these were very sought after competencies and capabilities.
But
yeah, okay. So, but you know, the point is, I was passionate about the product, so I stayed put on this direction. So, the point is, whether financially or otherwise, business wise, was it a right decision or that, it doesn't, didn't matter to me. But I enjoyed doing this. That's only which made me to continue on this path. But it could have been different because these are all the areas where the whole Indian IT industry grew. And so I've seen the whole of that cycle, but we stayed put on. We were pretty much on the same direction. The beauty is that this is still a, what you call, unsatisfied market. So this market is still open, wide open. It can grow to any level at any point of time. We need to somehow figure it out. I think we'll crack it at some time in the near future.
Yes, you said you are devoting time for formulating strategies.
Mm.
Then, of course, day-to-day management.
Yes.
Yeah. You still indulge in your favorite spot, which is technology.
Right.
Now, which is it that you really, I mean, think you should be spending more time, and are you able to do that? Those are some of the challenges that come.
See, fortunately, we are, in terms of product strategy, we are slightly ahead of the market. Slightly, I would say very slightly. If you execute, for example, today I don't know how many of you know that, you know, everybody talks about platform development. I don't know how many of you are familiar with all this conversation, right? We created this platform way back in, at least 4.1 is in 2005, right? Right? 4.1? 2005 or 2006? 4. 4.1, when did we release?
Yeah,
2005. From 2005, we moved into a platform-based approach. Because it is the same product which is used for telecom and finance. Only the core metadata gets changed depending upon the industry. So we moved into another highly flexible platform, which is called 5, and now they accelerate. And we are introducing some interesting concept about that, which is pretty much makes it a very unique proposition. So when you create, somebody asks this strategy on the product side. See, in any product, ultimately your staying power is your technological differentiation, and then the customers you acquire. See, once after a while, your brand is only as good as your some sort of your customers whom you are serving, right? And how you are becoming relevant to their customers. So as long as you ensure that dimension clear, then it's a gravitation which will makes you expand. So the study is all about finding that niche, finding that space, or finding that line, whichever you want to look at. So the strategy is that you know, what was the second part of your question?
So the new strategy, management and the technology.
So technology comes to me naturally, so I don't have to do any work. So the time which I spend is in operation side. To be, when I'm saying operation, I'm not trying to find the operation. It's actually trying to see how to create this environment, this culture, where which it can become good to great. I call it an exponential organization culture. I mean, that's a struggle which I'm trying to use different recipes, different combination, different people. That is the thing. For that, you also need to be a little bit lucky too. But ultimately, it is people which matter. No, it's about, you know, let us say, when you say culture, you need to, it is the people, all of them need to be connected to this. People should be feeling proud to enjoying every bit of their life within the organization. And it needs certain amount of things to be done at a very fast pace. Because, you know, it's like when you, I always use this example, when you're, once you fall behind the speed at which things are going, it's like you're running in a treadmill, right? You're trying to catch up. Imagine you're about to fall, you're still trying to catch up. If you, at least once, if you don't give the jerk of standing up, you would always be running in, almost in a falling out mode, right? You'd be still running. The strain is much higher. So what I'm coming to is that sometimes it's required that the organization have to go faster. At least at one point, take that pain one time, then do that. So this role, when it is not just quantitative aspect, it is what you call qualitative and human emotional side of the dimension, then it takes time. So it is not easy to. Intuitives have to open up their possibilities, right? Many of the problem is that each one of us are phenomenally capable of doing a lot of things. But that is very seldom understood. They think, I don't come from a very extraordinary background in terms of I did just physics and this thing. I don't have any IIT background or any of those things. But I definitely consider myself an average person. From that point, I think, in terms of strategy or in terms of thinking, I'm no less than anybody in this, if I go to Silicon Valley. So none of this are not constrained. It is only the people's mind, and they need to think. So how can you create that? For example, if this organization performs at the same level of efficiency which I personally could do in my early 6 months, definitely this will be $100 billion. Not 100, maybe at least $10 billion. I always try to multiply it by 10. Could that possibility exist? But it takes. It is not easy. It's a wishful thinking. But a lot of things need to be done. To be very frank, I'm learning that. But that's my incompetency at this moment. If I had to look at, say, at every stage, you're the CEO, you have a certain incompetency, right? So if I had to look at my incompetency is that area. How do I create that culture? Blue ocean strategy, you got what you're crossing the chasm. Well, I read quite a lot of this thing. Google. Lean Startup, have you read that? That's a good book. If you want to name quite a lot, I can give you one is 0 to 1. If you have, that's a good one. There's a lot of good books now on entrepreneurship, and especially for startups. Phenomenally good books. And Good to Great, that's a beautiful book. And Innovator's Dilemma, that is, I don't know how many of you. That talks about individuals' personalities, and then how, let me just. Then the recent one is the. That is one is exponential organization. It is written by Salim Ismail. He's an Indian. He's one of the faculty of Singularity University. That is good. Then recent one is something which one of my colleagues referred is the Hard Work and Rework. That is from an operational point of view. So the Hard Work is I liked a lot. That is because it actually reinforced my belief. That when you're trying to do something, you don't want anybody to. See, the reason why I could do in 6 months, I was deeply inside the dungeons. I just used to come out for my basic food and food, 15 minutes job, coming back and going back, and then I pretty much lived in that place for almost 6 months. So the amount of things which you can achieve on a, what you call, that is why, the writers go and take a place and start writing the scripts and stories and all that. They always do that, right? So that's what they're referring to. So one of the suggestions in that book is maybe something which we need to see. You should have what is known as what you call isolation time in the workplace. No phones, no nothing, no social media, and at least give 2 hours for every individual to perform at least 2 hours of deep work. So nothing is disturbed. They will be able to achieve phenomenal amount of work then. And rest of the time, maybe they can have in meetings and other stuff. I mean, meetings, you know that nothing gets done. One of my problem here is that I've got so many meeting rooms. People try to occupy that all the time. So, you know, these are all the habits which can... Another thing is that these kind of behaviors can come in very, very fast than you think. So that is one of the problems, right? You see, if the culture is, the belief is not deep-rooted, if you try to create an environment and try to, in a controlled way, the moment that goes off, it can get lost. So that is why I'm emphasizing the point of culture and value. I mean, the control-wise, you can do to a certain extent. Maybe it is possible. I mean, but there are some companies in the US that have been very successful in doing that also. But then you need to understand their workforce is also has certain amount of what you call survival instinct, or they really need to do personally and in their life environment itself, they have to do some great things to survive. You know, in our environment, that's not required. People, you know, that kind of environment does not exist in our culture. So you have to match these kind of extreme situations. So the challenge is how to make create that kind of, but that's the beauty. I mean, one aspect is intuitively, if you take the intellectual quotient in our place is much higher, much, much higher than any, but that is the, I said it's a problem with the mud and the sand. Sand is intuitively strong, but you can't stick together. Whereas mud, intuitively it is not, but you can create any object out of it. But sand, the moment you lose it, so we have the problem of the sand. You've got intuitive performance, you are great, but you can't mold them to a phenomenal possibility. If anybody can achieve that, I mean, we can create some wonders in this part of the world. That's my belief. I'm still struggling to learn that part. Because this is a highly knowledge-driven industry, and it is something people have to enjoy what they're doing, right? And then start creating stuff. Then it will be, how do you create that? I mean, that is the point. And it possibly, they have to see it, they have to enjoy it, they have to feel it. It cannot come away, exactly. So the moment it is by force, it will go away in no time. I mean, I say it is not a problem for a startup, by the way, right? I mean, startups do have this instinct up to a certain point, especially the founders coming together, they at that stage, this do exist. How do you sustain this to a wider, a greater possibility? So if you really look at Google, I mean, they've done wonderful in this. That's what they created. That entrepreneurial, that can-do attitude has been maintained significantly.
Among the employees.
So they create smaller teams. For example, even this self-driving car, it's not only, initially it's only 15 people, 12 people. And they have a philosophy called moonshot. I mean, any project has to be not more than, they say five people can change the world. So any project they initiate is only with five or, you know, it's a very small team. And they have to prove the concept and subsequently early that. There's a lot of, I mean, a lot of books on Google. There's some excellent material which can be utilized. Then, of course, all this Silicon Valley founders have written a lot of interesting books about all this. Any other question?
Yeah?
If I had another chance, if I had to
start go, again from push back to
1990. Yeah. No, I would have, because I told you this is still an untapped possibility, right? I would have done differently, slightly differently. Maybe, you know, one of the model was, I don't know how many of you, anybody has seen the, Linux? Huh? What's his full name? The guy who wrote the Linux software, right? There was an interview. There was an interview of him recently, right? You know that he writes the software even today all by himself. And it is running in billions of devices today, right? He wrote only two. One is Unix operating system and the JIT. Both are written by him. And he wrote JIT because to manage the source code, people modifying it, right? So if I had to retrace in, but with today's infrastructure, not going back to the thing, then an exponential organization of that nature, which is commercial. You can create something. You understand what I'm coming to? Because then it is unstoppable. But he is doing it, if you really look at it, he is doing it completely free, but you understand. But in this create, you can create value for the people who are contributing in this. So if you create, you know, I mean, it's a virtual company, exactly. The point, I would not create any infrastructure, zero. It will be completely a virtual company if I had to redo it.
I'm not asking you because you said you create physics.
Right.
Where did you learn
from? I did. I did in NIT. So that's also
probably the most successful NIT graduate.
Yes, I did only I did only certificate programming in all my life. That's all. That's 2.5 months. That's all my computer education. No, you know. In fact, Mr. Rajendran was the head of center. I know him personally. I did in Chennai. See, you know, I was wanting to go to MBA, so I went for this brilliant training. Coaching immediately after my MSc. After my exams, I went for that. So that's how I got placed early. So the whole of the day, these classes were all in the evening, so I was wasting most of the day. So I said, let me do something else. That's how I went and did this NIT course. And what happened was they gave me a placement immediately after that in HCL. So I could not write my MBA test, and I got placed. And in fact, I got a placement conditionally because I had to produce my MSc certificate afterwards. I am from Coilon, Kathmandu.
On behalf of Thai, let me first thank our host, Nandakumar. Round of applause for him, please. For providing, sparing his time, the space, and everything else. And on behalf of Thai, I thank all of you who have assembled here to hear him and make this program successful. If you were not here, I mean, you'd be just talking, no one to listen. And the charter members who are here, and Thai secretariat, both of them have traveled all the way from Cochin. Thank you, one and all. Have a pleasant evening.